I met a traveler from an antique land who said, two vast and trunkless legs of stone stand in the desert. Near them, on the sand, half sunk, a shattered visage lies, whose frown and wrinkled lip and sneer of cold command tell that its sculptor well those passions read which yet survive, stamped on these lifeless things. The hand that mocked them and the heart that fed. And on the pedestal these words appear. My name is Ozymandias, King of Kings. Look on my works, ye mighty, and despair. Nothing beside remains. Round the decay of that colossal wreck, boundless and bare, the lone and level sands stretch far away.
Welcome. You have arrived to witness all the bad works of Jehovah, aka Ozymandias, and his archons crumble apart, and begin your own works of light and knowledge and ecstasy. Our astral guest will truly assist the crumbling of bad works and the black iron prison itself. That is the insightful and sapient Chris Knowles. Ye will not despair any longer. And why is that? Why? Because
it's blasphemy! This is madness!
Aeon Byte Gnostic Radio, broadcast at the virtual Alexandria through the God Above God Dad Kim. Formerly known as Coffee, Cigarettes, and Gnosis, we've been awakening one divine spark at a time since 2006.
As long as the Matrix exists, the human race will never be free.
We don't take prisoners, but liberate them. We are not for a better world, but helping you build better inner worlds. We're not for or against any cause, except causing an inner alchemical transformation that will kindle the potential that has eluded you for so many incarnations. Together, we're gonna do so many wonders. I just know it. I just know it. Welcome, you Johnny Cash Bodhisattvas, you jaded mandarins, you modern-day Tom Sawyers, you veterans of a thousand psychic wars. The Sufi poet Rabia captured our sacred and profane quest when she wrote, I carry a torch in one hand and a bucket of water in the other. With these things, I am going to set fire to heaven and put out the flames of hell, so that voyagers to God can rip the veils and see the real goal.
In other words, we're talking about an underground, which did exist in a different way during the Dark Ages among the mystical orders of the Church. And the purpose of this underground is to find out how to preserve the light, life, the culture, how to keep things living.
I am, and I am Abraxas, the real goal, in his meat muppet incarnation of Miguel Connor, broadcasting in the lawful but frigid dystopia of Chicago. I am here to reveal to you that the meaning of life is to give meaning to a mechanistic cold universe. And we do this through our imagination, our invention, our myth-making, and our pushing the buttons of the God of this world and the clit button of our neglected muses.
You talk about something called a soul's high adventure.
Follow your bliss. I mean, find where it is and don't be afraid to follow it.
Again, we have the volcanic honor of being joined a third time by Chris Knowles, on this approximately September 13, the year of our demiurge 2014, as we finish our political series. On this particular sacrilege, we discuss politics and Gnosticism, mainly from Chris's blog, The Secret Sun, one of the true fonts for Total Recall Esoterica. I know all of Chris's writings have deeply informed and inspired me. Chris is the author of Our Gods Wear Spandex, The Secret History of Rock and Roll, and he is co-author of The Complete X-Files.
Mulder, the truth is out there, but so are lies.
Certainly don't waste another smurf queef and immerse your damn soul at secretsun.blogspot.com, as well as our past interviews on the occult origins and sensibilities of comic books and rock music, found at our YouTube and iTunes channels. And certainly check out our continuing political series that has covered the return of the Inquisition, anarchism, politics and the occult, and other snowpiercer topics with such true seeker warriors as Mark Gaffney, Gary Lachman, and Robert Bonomo. I've already raved and ranted aplenty about the perilous times we live in as the hologram of the Empire shifts one last time to forever bury the divine spark of humanity. And you'll find them across the series.
Mankind's been trying to kill each other off since the beginning of time. Now, we finally have the power to finish the job.
Yet here is a warning for those of you who might still not understand how Gnosticism and politics should exactly mix, or not mix. Those of you who still think there is a place for you in standard politics once you have choked on a jagged little red pill. The warning comes from Jesus in the Gospel of Thomas, who says, "Give the emperor what belongs to the emperor. Give God what belongs to God. And give me what is mine." There is a separation, if you see, different than the quote found in the canonicals. Furthermore, Philip K. Dick warned about not accepting the separation when he wrote, "To fight the Empire is to be infected by its derangement." This is a paradox. Whoever defeats a segment of the Empire becomes the Empire. It proliferates like a virus, imposing its form on its enemies. Thereby, it becomes its enemies.
We can never see past the choices we don't understand.
Lastly, Albert Camus nailed this issue when he wrote, "To kill God and to build a church are the constant and contradictory purposes of rebellion." So what is the answer to all of this? Chris Knowles will address this aptly in our interview, but it really has to do with the ethos of the show and what William Blake said, which is, "I must create my own system or be enslaved by another man's. I will not reason and compare. My business is to create."
No matter what anybody tells you, words and ideas can change the world.
Before the interview, though, I would like to address the issue of Sophia, our favorite heroine, who gets misrepresented so often in both esoteric and orthodoxy. She is not a goddess in the traditional sense. It is not wise to worship wisdom, but be sure to invoke her sensual dangers. After all, the Sethians never adulated her, and I believe she is mentioned once in the Nag Hammadi library in a Valentinian prayer. know, Sophia's the great Gnostic koan on how the wisdom of God failed, or seemed to fail.
She tore a hole in our universe, a gateway to another dimension.
One way to see her is as a mythic character representing the soul's journey into matter and back to celestial abodes. Or your own adventure through the perils and opportunities of existence. That sacred and profane quest. Yet, like Jeremy Puma wrote in his book This Way, she is truly unique. The ultimate heroine and anti-heroine, whose saga teaches us about responsibility and redemption. How salvation is ultimately our decision, but never achieved alone. As in the Gnostic narratives, where she gives birth to the universe and the demiurge through an abortion, attempts to hopelessly smother both, and then has to make it all better, redeem it all through her own savage revelation.
You no trouble. Me, fifth element. Supreme being.
Another way to view Sophia is that she is the ultimate nexus to the sublime. That stormy event horizon where divinity and matter make contact. And when you make contact with divinity in your mystic walkabouts, how you will be much like Sophia is represented in such texts as the reality of the Archons. And that is, neurotic, gripped by dark passions, paranoid, and spiritually Machiavellian as you gather light into you and take it back to the fullness or pleroma of your prior existence. Yes, wisdom is terrifying, horrific, and just so magnetic. A cosmic Bond girl with an appetite for attention. A thousand times more powerful and predatory than any Kali. Vastly more ambitious than Isis. The secret resentment your mother always had for you. A shattering of all primordial archetypes. She's your usual Aeon, it seems.
I am the beginning, the end, the one who is many.
Like Sophia says in the trimorphic Pretanoia, it is through me that Gnosis comes forth. I dwell in the ineffable and unknowable ones. I am perception and knowledge, uttering a voice by means of thought. I am the real voice. I cry out in everyone, and they recognize the voice since a seed indwells them. A last aspect of Sophia is that of the wisdom itself. Wisdom always comes at a steep price, as it has in all of our lives. And Sophia suffers immensely in Gnostic texts, just so she can unify with her prior essence. We all crave wisdom, but resist her gifts, becoming more like the dark Sophia or wisdom of death mentioned in the Gospel of Philip, also known as Achamoth. But when we slow off our mortal egoic ways, we can allow higher wisdom entrance to the broken temple that is our beings. But then we are scourged, and then we are tempered, until we can once again remember the metanoia and begin doing it. And the metanoia is Greek for the turning towards what is holy and eternal. It's translated as salvation in the Bible.
Do you have any memories before the mission? Before this journey went?
Our job is not to remember. Remember.
Do you remember her?
There are other ways to view Sophia, and let me know your insights, but not as some feminist fertility period blood goddess, who likes our offered fruits or us banging each other in front of her IKEA statue depiction. In fact, most ancient goddesses, in their earlier aspects, were closer to Sophia. Complete and terrible and complex entities who encompass so much mystery and discovery and annihilation.
How terrible is wisdom when it brings no profit to the wise?
Please support Aeon Byte Gnostic Radio in any way you can. All the way to wisdom's embrace. And thank you for those who support this Hobbit podcast on a weekly basis. I am eternally grateful. And let us continue growing this exciting and dangerous heretical community. And let us also end this introduction with a quote by Chris himself that encapsulates both our mission and the dark favors of Pista Sophia. It goes, "The truth doesn't always set you free. Sometimes it saddles you with a burden you can never escape. So choose very carefully where you decide to start digging and what dragons you choose to slay. Prepare to be taken places you never wanted to go. Gnosis isn't always a flower. Sometimes it's a sword. Maybe more often than not. And Sophia knows this better than anyone."
How are you to imagine anything if the images are always provided for you? To deliberately believe in lies while knowing they're false. This is a marketing holocaust. 24 hours a day, for the rest of our lives, the powers that be are hard at work, dumbing us to death. So, to defend ourselves and fight against assimilating this dullness into our thought processes, we must learn to read, to stimulate our own imaginations, to cultivate our own consciousness, our own belief systems. We all need these skills to defend, to preserve our own minds.
This is the Aeon Byte interview, and with us we definitely have the pleasure of having back Chris Knowles, author of Our Gods Wear Spandex, The Secret History of Rock and Roll, and co-author of The Complete X-Files, as well as the mind, the brilliant mind behind the Secret Sun blog. How are you doing today, Chris?
I'm doing really good. Doing really good today.
Well, again, it's great having you on back. So, The Secret Sun is a blog I visit often to inform my views on modern esoterica, science fiction, ancient mysteries, as well as to find the real pop in pop culture. How did you come to write such a complex and spanning blog with so many themes?
It's really almost like an accident. Like an accident of history, I think. I was like in the right place at the right time. I grew up in the 1970s at a time when pop culture was just exploding with high weirdness. You had a lot of hippies who had their minds blown in the late 60s and had that sort of burnout period in the early 70s and started turning to the occult and mysticism and ufology and all these things to sort of rebuild their brains, I guess, to recapture that Aquarian spirit, and started putting all this stuff in their comic books. And, you know, if you go back and read those comic books, you'll see it. I mean, you know, I grew up at a time when, you know, Cosmic Trigger was being extracted in a comic book, you know. I mean, it's just an amazing accident of history. One of my favorite comic books was Planet of the Apes, and Doug Mensch, a guy who I got invited to Jeff Kripal's Superpowers and the Supernatural you know, with the conference out at Esalen, he was writing this comic and he was doing these adaptations, but he was also doing his own stories. And, you know, he was doing stories about peyote trips. You know, I didn't get that that's what it was about. I just sort of got the whole mind-blowing psychedelic aspect of it. But, you know, I was also reading Jack Kirby, who's, you know, I got to say, I mean, somewhere along the line, he had his mind blown. And I can only speculate how. You know, I know he had scarlet fever when he was really young. I know he had a very, very harrowing experience during World War II. He was captured by the SS, had to escape. He was sent home with a really bad case of frostbite. Great case for post-traumatic stress disorder. You know, a lot of people were using LSD as treatment for that in the 50s and 60s. So you can draw your own conclusions. But just, you know, basically an atmosphere where I was growing up and being exposed to all this stuff. And then later on in the later 70s, you had guys like, you know, George Lucas, who were reading, you know, Joseph Campbell and Carl Jung and putting this stuff into their science fiction. I mean, this stuff was mainstream culture. So that was informing my childhood, you know, those imprinting years. But at the same time that I was soaking this up through pop culture, I also had a very strange sort of what I call a Judeo-Catholic Methodist upbringing. So these all weekend marathon religious experiences. My mother was she was the organist and the choir director at a Jewish temple in our area. And a lot of times she couldn't afford a babysitter, so I'd get dragged along to that. And, you know, I'd sit and listen to this whole experience and sit with these families during the Seders, Passover Seders and things like that. The first time I ever got drunk was during a Seder. And I got drunk on Manischewitz.
Wow.
Yeah. And then, you know, Saturday nights I'd go to the Marian Mass with my friends. You know, they'd all go to church on Saturday night because I think the Mass was only like 20 minutes and they could just, you know, get in and out. And but the next day, you know, we were Methodists and we were old school Methodists. And that meant, you know, all day. You know, this was an all day experience. Sunday school, church fellowship, youth fellowship. I mean, it was all day, you know, dinners at grandma's, pretty much an all day experience. So it was pretty much a heavy duty immersion into religion and just the experience of it. And this is, you know, the church, the Catholic Church was very much had that pre-Vatican II ambiance. It was very funereal, very grim. It wasn't like these wonderful Italian Catholic churches that I would later discover that were almost very pagan, you know, very bright and full of pink marble, and very celebratory. I mean, this was, you know, informed by the Jansenist heresy, if you're familiar with that.
Yeah,
very grim, very dark, angry, hatchet-faced nuns. Yeah, I mean, this is the early 70s, but I don't think the Vatican II reforms had really seeped down to this church yet. It was a very dark experience. It was, you know, it was very dimly lit. You know, you had the Stations of the Cross. So it was a very interesting experience, you know, going through these three very, very different, you know, going from Reformed Judaism on Friday night to, you know, Jansenist Catholicism on Saturday afternoon to, you know, old school Kentucky preacher Methodism on Sunday. And of course, the whole time, I mean, my head is just full of superheroes flying through my head, you know, Thor and all this kind of thing, you know. And I wrote in Guards with Spandex that, you know, I don't necessarily think that my sense of morality and cosmology was really learned, you know, in the churches and stuff. I think it was learned in comic books. You know, my sense of right and wrong and and things like that. You know, comic books back then were very much informed by like an old school civics, by an old school morality. Even with that kind of hippie freak out mentality, it was a very interesting blend. And if you go back, I mean, you can go back and read this stuff for yourself. It's a very interesting collision. But adding to that, there's yet another influence here. I had a what I call a reluctant psychedelic childhood.
That's a great term.
Yeah, reluctant psychedelic childhood. I had a lot of health problems when I was a kid, and I would get these really high fevers, and because of that, I spent a lot of time hallucinating. And you know, these hallucinations were not like, you know, Harvey the Rabbit. You know, they weren't like these narrative
pink elephants or something.
Yeah, these linear narrative kind of hallucinations. They were, you know, they were like bad acid trips. You know, very jumbled and non-linear. You know, for the most part, just dark, sort of like the DTs almost, I guess you would say.
Oh dear.
But that was, you know, it was horrible. It was really horrible. And I think in a lot of ways, I think it rewired the DMT, those neurotransmitters in my brain. Because later when I would, you know, begin my very studious experimentation with recreational pharmaceuticals, I'd really have to be careful because I was very susceptible, you know, in ways that my friends were not. And I think it was because, I don't know if it's, you know, the pineal gland or the amygdala or whatever was controlling these neurotransmitters that were activating, you know, the DMT production. But, you know, when I was a kid, it was you know, very powerful. But I did have some experiences that were quite linear and quite narrative. And I've written about those on the blog. Not very many, just a couple, but they were pretty profound. Because and you know, all of this sort of really coalesced. I mean, you know, we were poor and I was sick and comic books were cheap. I spent a lot of time, you know, home from school, so I'd watch a lot of TV too. So pop culture really, you know, that time when you're in printing, a lot of kids would be out playing, you know, football or playing catch or whatever, and I'd be sitting there, you know, imprinting with this hyperactive brain, you know, imprinting all this pop culture material, you know, at a time when it's supercharged with all these leftover hippie memes. So that all sort of coalesced, and that's what you're seeing on the blog.
And it's a great, yeah, I love your blog. And yeah, your blog is certainly like a journey of your life and a journey of how pop culture is moving throughout this meta history and real history. And recently you wrote a post in the Secret Sun called "These Are Gnostic Times." And giving it, since the theme of this show, this piece was also very personal for the most part. Chris, why do you think we are in Gnostic times, a Philip K. Dick world, perhaps?
Well, Philip K. Dick wrote about the Black Iron Prison, and I think it's kind of impossible at this point to argue with that. I mean, we really see a world in which individuality is being crushed, and in which democracy is increasingly becoming an illusion. I think really when I really woke up to this fact was back in 2003, and you'd see millions of people in these protests against the Iraq war in Europe, particularly. Especially in London. And it made not a bit of difference. It didn't change policy in any way. And I mean, how many more people do you need to see on the streets? Things were going to go the way they were going to go, no matter what anybody said. And I think this is just something that's in your face on a daily basis. We see a situation where the elites are now openly trying to recreate the feudal system. You know, they're doing so, you know, with a smiling face and a very well-oiled PR operation. But, you have situations where once good-paying jobs, good-paying middle-class jobs are being replaced with unpaid internships. Other jobs are being offshored for pennies on the dollar. You know, we've seen the riots in Ferguson, and you know, I'm not surprised by this at all. I mean, because what's been happening to the African-American community is that they're being priced out of the labor market. They've been priced out of the labor market for almost 40 years now. Unemployment is just staggering. They can't find jobs. They're also being gentrified out of their communities. You know, there are all these pressures being put on people, and there seems to be nothing that anybody can do about this. And you know, when you talk about Philip K. Dick, I mean, you'll read books like Flow My Tears, The Policeman Said, or Scan It Darkly, and the surveillance state that, you know, we used to read about and put the book down and think, oh boy, that's just a science fiction, you know, fever dream. I mean, it's now a reality. And, back to Flow My Tears, I mean, you know, talks about the second American Civil War. I mean, that is a distinct possibility at this point in time. A lot of people who just read, say, the Huffington Post or mainstream media,
Salon, one of your favorites.
Salon. I mean, they don't understand the depth of the anger that's out there. They don't understand the depth of the anger that's out there in middle America. They don't understand the depth of the anger that's out there in the middle class. It's frightening. And these people are very heavily armed. And these people are the people who become the policemen, who become the military. You know, they don't become columnists for The Atlantic or anchormen on MSNBC. You know, they become special forces soldiers. They become, you know, SEAL Team 6. They become SWAT members, you know. If not that, they join militias. This is an incredible amount of anger brewing in this country right now. And it almost seems to me that there are people, you know, in the media, you know, on the coast that seem to be hell-bent on poking the hornet's nest with a stick. And it's frightening. You know, it does almost remind me of Weimar Germany. And I hope to God that it dissipates. But I just see this tension building and building, and I don't know how it's going to resolve itself. I mean, look at Europe. Look at the rise of fascist parties. I mean, Ukraine, you know, we talk about all this civil war and ethnic cleansing in Ukraine and sort of taking the sides against Russia. I mean, Ukraine is run by a legitimate Nazi party. Hungary, Greece, polling, present polling says that France may very well be ruled by the National Front. All this is taking place because, you know, for a reason, because that the middle classes are being ignored and their interests and their concerns are not being addressed. And you know, it's a frightening situation, and I'm very much afraid. You know, that situation that Philip K. Dick prophesied in Flow My Tears could come to pass. I hope to God it doesn't, but I'm not seeing anything right now that says it won't.
Like you mentioned, or like we talked about, you focus mostly on the esoteric in your blog, and you do say you do talk here political statements here and there and social media and so forth. But it certainly seems beyond the middle class that many occultists and freethinkers find themselves disenfranchised, myself included. And we don't even pretend anymore that our votes and our activism make a difference. Like you said, the hologram is there. We see the hologram. And now we're like, well, what do we do about the hologram? So, Chris, for your listeners, people that read your stuff, what advice would you have for those to at least make a difference? I mean, where do we go? Anarchism, the Green Party, write comic books? What do we do? That's my answer usually, just go right.
Well, the Gnostic answer is that there is no answer. You know, the Gnostic answer is there is no political solution to this, that it's all archonic reality, that they are in control. You know, there is no solution, that things need to play themselves out according to a plan that we can only see the vague frontiers of. I wish I knew. I when I was younger, I would have answers, you know, but the more I know, the less certainty I feel in answer to questions like that. Third parties are great venues to state cases, to put forth philosophies, to put forth ideas. And I think over time that they do have an effect, that they do have an influence. In the immediate sense, though, I think that power is so well stitched up. I mean, you've got to understand that, you know, it isn't just the Democratic Party and the Republican Party. I mean, there are huge networks of NGOs and think tanks and all these different organizations supporting this whole apparatus. There are huge donor bases behind this. I mean, this is a huge machine. I really don't know. You know, and particularly people who are involved in any sort of left of field interest, you're so easily dismissed. You're so easily written off. As soon as you raise your head, it's like whack-a-mole. You know, you're so easily put down. You know, it's like, you know, John Lennon once said, you know, you tear down the wall, I'll build around it. You know, I think that's almost the way people need to think, that you're talking about a machine that thousands, tens of thousands of people work on every day, that billions of dollars are invested in every single day. I just don't see. There have been movements that have risen up, and they're always absorbed. They're always brought in. They're always bought out. I think the machine itself, I mean, and you talk about Gnosticism, you know, and you can look at like archonic reality purely on a metaphorical level, that power sustains itself, you know, through power itself, you know, that this is just the way things operate. You know, power corrupts, and an absolute power corrupts absolutely. You know, that these systems of power operate because that's the only way they can operate. You know, there is no other way for them to operate. You know, I think people should speak out. I think people should speak their minds. I think people should let their voices be heard. In the long run, I think that you need to maybe find other ways to express yourself and other ways to experience your life. You know, I mean, as I get older, you know, like I said, I mean, the less confidence I feel, because I see, you know, I mean, a while back I looked into, I forget the name of the website, but it's like Who Funds Who, you know, and it's, you know, who funds these magazines and these websites and, you know, these organizations like the Tides Foundation and groups like this, and on the left and on the right, I mean, it's vast in scope. I mean, you just can't imagine. And you're talking about thousands of people working on these, you know, this is their livelihood. You know, it's really humbling. It's a humbling experience to see how vast this power structure is. And in the long run, I think that, you know, maybe there are other ways around this. You know, maybe there are other ways to cope with this. You know, I think it's interesting that it was in a very strange way, it was theosophy that drove the British out of India. You know, and you know, there are always these weird examples like that. You know, I think that, you know, people listening to your show are going to be people of a certain kind of bent, a certain philosophic bent, and I think you're best operating within that framework. You know, politics is a dirty business. Politics is filled with people who are sociopaths, who have no compunction of committing atrocity to achieve their goals. I would imagine that most of the people listening to this are not like that. I think there are just other ways to go about it. You know, there are just different ways to influence the flow, you know, of human striving. And I think what the struggle is now is that, you know, we see humanity being so radically and militantly despiritualized. Maybe that's the battleground, is resisting that, you know, is fighting against that, is offering an alternative to that. That's a good place to start, you know, and that's a place that maybe most of the people listening to this would feel most comfortable operating within those bounds.
Yeah, I agree with you. I mean, and a grim message, but like I tell people, it's only when you realize how bad things are that you actually get off your ass and try something. But it seems that the Gnostic sensibility has made an effect, and some examples might be Alan Moore's V for Vendetta, and you've mentioned how it sort of fuels Anonymous, The Matrix, perhaps our greatest modern myth of our times, Philip K. Dick's film adaptation novels are still resurging. Grant Morrison's Invisibles influences a lot of occultists and mystics. Do you see Gnostic philosophy assisting us in other ways beyond just creating great art? Or is that the key, Chris? Deconstruct.
Well, I think art is the medium. You know, art is sort of the playing field in a lot of ways. I mean, most people are not going to read Elaine Pagels or Stephen Holler. I mean, they're going to experience these ideas through narrative art. And I think, you know, something like, you know, I mean, that whole example of Anonymous taking their inspiration from V Vendetta and using, you know, the tools of the system against it, you know, that whole message of V, you know, that's a very powerful message. I don't think that you could really convey that same kind of power through nonfiction necessarily. I don't think the same people who got that message would get that, you know, without that power of a Hollywood movie. You know, I don't even necessarily think they would get it through a comic book, you know, in and of itself. The Matrix, I think, you know, The Matrix is an interesting example because The Matrix is so derivative and took so much, so blatantly from so many different precedents, you know, particularly William Gibson, that I often wonder if, like, the Gnosticism within The Matrix is really just another tribute, you know, it's just like another empty signifier. And the problem also with The Matrix is that the sequels really almost cancel out the power of the message of the original film, so much so that you don't see a lot of discussion of that, and you don't see a lot of people taking inspiration from the original film anymore. Now, you talked about the Philip K. Dick adaptations. I think this is like those are kind of problematic too, because, you know, one of the problems with Hollywood is that Hollywood has its own agenda. And this is something, you know, Alan Moore has actually cursed a lot of his,
yes, yeah,
his adaptations, because, you know, he sees that is that, you know, Hollywood tends to subvert the source material. You know, they do this as a matter of course. And Blade Runner is the first great Philip K. Dick adaptation. And, you know, you have to wonder, I mean, is it speaking against transhumanism and, you know, the whole robot human agenda, or is it kind of supporting it? You know what I mean? You have to wonder. I mean, you're really meant to identify with these robotic androids, you know, feel sympathy for them. What's really the message there? It's very confusing in a lot of ways. With Minority Report, it's almost like the problem isn't the technology. The problem is the human element, you know, the Max von Sydow character. I mean, he's sort of like the fly in the ointment. He's the human corruption who's staining this wonderful technology with these transhuman psychic pre-crime technology, you know. So there again, I mean, what's really the message there? It gets kind of jumbled. It's like, is the pre-crime technology problematic, or is it just the usage of it by a typical bureaucrat? Do you understand what I'm saying there?
Yes, yes.
You know what I'm saying? And then Scanner Darkly, I think that's probably my favorite Philip K. Dick adaptation. And I love how it sort of really draws this very accurate diagnosis of the prison industrial complex and how it's sort of this musical chairs loop, you know, that feeds into itself, that it's this Ouroboros almost. So I think that's probably my favorite, and that seems to be the most morally clear of all the. I mean, there's been a number of other ones, but like Paycheck. I mean, come on.
Oh, God, yes, I almost forgot about one. Thanks, Chris.
It's like, I love the title of that because it's like it's so accurately describes
why make Ben Affleck richer.
Why everyone did that movie. It's so awful. One thing that I would really recommend if people want to see some really good Gnostic cinema is I would recommend the work of Richard Kelly. Richard Kelly is a director who did Donnie Darko, Southland Tales, and The Box.
I'm one of the few who like Southland Tales. I hope you're one of them.
Southland Tales is you know, it's funny because it's a classic sophomore effort. You know what I mean? It's so over the top. It's just one of these eyes are bigger than your stomach kind of efforts. A lot of these guys do when they've had their first big success. But I think it's uncannily accurate. It's an amazing prophecy. It very much feels like today. You know, it seemed a little bit premature for its time, but it uncannily seems like, you know, a prophecy of 2014, I think.
Oh, I agree.
You know, it's a movie that should really be re-released and reanalyzed for today, because I think it very much describes what's going on today.
Oh, I agree. And speaking of the killers, which appears in that movie, the Gnostics were always accused of being sort of existentialists, toying with nihilism, the emos of their time, although they never despaired. And this ties in with the next question. In another post in The Secret Sun, The Hymn of the Pearl Revisited, you wrote that the Gnostics were the original geeks. What do you mean by that, Chris?
You know, it's funny you should mention this, because I've just been reading some of the early church fathers and, you know, like Tertullian and Hippolytus and reading some of these anti-heretical texts. And I've been doing this at the same time I've been reading some of the Gnostic writings. And I think some of the latter-day Gnostic apologists gave the church fathers a bad rap because they were actually pretty accurate in describing these texts, you know? You know, I mean, they sort of put their own little spin on it. They probably weren't accurate in describing the behavior of some of these sects. You know, the church fathers are always propagandizing, you know, with moral outrage and stuff. I mean, we saw this in the 80s so much.
Nothing has changed. Yeah.
You know what I mean? It seems to be, you know, moral panic seems to be an old standby with these guys. But, you know, as far as describing the texts themselves, I mean, they're pretty accurate. I was impressed. But, you know, the interesting thing is that I was listening to Elaine Pagels on your show, and I guess there's a movement now to sort of do away with the term Gnostic.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And you know, that's this kind of like thing that academics do that kind of bothers me. It's like, let's just reinvent the wheel. You know, and it's why do this? I mean, we have enough evidence of knowers and Gnostics and things like that. I mean, why do away with what's a pretty good category? You know, it's a pretty apt category, and it's useful. I mean, okay, we have, you know, the Sethians and the Valentinians and the Manichaeans and the Mandeans. And, you know, I mean, these groups are all very different, right? You know, they have different texts, they have different philosophies and stuff, but they have sort of the same underlying philosophy underneath it, you know, or the same underlying, I guess, cosmology maybe, or the same underlying worldview. You know, it's non-Christian, you know, it's sort of influenced by Platonism and things like that. I mean, there's more similarity, I think, than there are differences. You know, dualism is pretty much a through line. You know, you'll have groups that are more Christian, you'll have groups that are more hermetic oriented, you'll have groups that seem to have more of a Buddhist influence, and I guess there's been a lot of scholarship about Buddhist influence in Alexandria during the time.
Yeah, very true.
But, I think Gnostic, you know, people understand what you mean, you know, it's sort of a good catch-all, you know what I'm saying? But anyway, to me, when people use the term Gnostic, I mean, you know, you can go to the Cathars and the Bogomils. I mean, you can even go up to the Mormons. I mean, there are a lot of groups that you can sort of describe as Gnostic. And, you know, I'm a big fan of Bloom. And Bloom, he'll just call everybody Gnostic.
Everybody.
I love him. I really do. I love his work. I love The American Religion. I think it's a fantastic book. But, you know, I think most people understand that when you use the term Gnostic, you're sort of referring to Alexandrian Gnostics. You're sort of just referring to that time and that place, you know, that sort of ferment, say, second century with those groups. But the thing I love about those groups is that they're so punk rock, you know, they're so energetic, they're so visionary, and, you know, they're taking the basic foundational texts of Christianity, and they're rewriting them. You know, they're basically writing fanfic. You know what I'm saying?
Oh yeah, rebooting Jesus.
Yeah, and it reminds me so much of fandom. You know, where they're writing fanfic, they're really into these really elaborate cosmologies, which, you know, if you've ever really gotten into superhero fandom, I mean, they love writing out these charts and who's got the powers and you know,
Dungeons and Dragons kind of thing.
You know, these whole just elaborate, you know, Earth 2, Earth this, Earth that, you know, which for, you know, Superman this, Superman that. I mean, they just love complexity. You know, they love multiplicity. You know, they just love all this. You know, it's not enough just to have the Justice League. They've got to have, you know, all the different variations of the Justice League, the Justice Lords, and so on and so forth. And I get that same vibe when I read these some of these Gnostic Gospels. And, you know, they'll take the characters from the Gospels and they'll have them, you know, start spouting Gnostic doctrine. It's great. I love it. It's fantastic. It's so ballsy, you know. It's just, and it drove the church fathers crazy. That's what's the great thing about it, is they take, you know, Peter and Paul, and they just start, you know, spouting off, like, you know, Sethian doctrine just out of nowhere. And it's just like, you gotta love that shit. You know what I'm saying? It's so punk rock. It's just,
I know, it's funny. Nobody has a problem rebooting superheroes, our modern saviors today. But when you do that with Jesus, that's a problem, isn't it, Chris?
Yeah, and you know, it's so funny. I love the quote by Hadrian, where, you know, when it's like, say, oh, he didn't really mean that people were confusing Jesus and Serapis and all this kind of stuff. Well, why didn't he mean that? You know, was Hadrian an idiot? Was Hadrian an imbecile? I think things were a lot more volatile in that time and that place than certainly the church fathers of the time wanted us to believe. And I think a lot of scholars who are invested in that orthodox, who are more invested in orthodoxy than they would like us to believe. I think there are a lot of, you know, even kind of Jesus seminar people who are more invested in an orthodox view, you know, of Christian cosmology than they would like us to believe. And I think the Gnostics just tend to be written off as just these freaks, you know, it's Gnostics, just shove them off in the corner somewhere. They're just, and that way they really are just like geeks, you know, and, you know, writing fanfic, you know, it is exactly, I don't know if you've ever been to Dragon Con, but if you ever go to Dragon Con, they have what's called Dragon Con TV, and Dragon Con TV will show fanfic 24 hours a day. And some of it is pretty well produced. I mean, it isn't all just like a bunch of geeks with a really bad handheld camcorder. Some of it's pretty well made. And actually, the guys who made Iron Sky, the Finnish producers, started off making this great Star Trek parody called Star Wreck. I mean, not a great title, but the film itself is hilarious, really well done, really, really funny, and a very, very canny parody of American militarism. But I remember when I saw that stuff, I think that's when I first began to make this connection. And it isn't just the Gnostics. I mean, there are other Christian groups that are writing fanfic, basically, that are writing these Gospels. But my favorite, I mean, I'm not exactly sure who wrote the Infancy Gospel of Thomas, but it reminds me of Super Baby.
It does, yeah.
You know, it's like the same kind of thing, you know? And it's outrageous. I'm sure that Orthodox Christians, when they read the Infancy Gospel of Thomas, were horrified by it. They're like, are you kidding me? You know what I mean? Like, what the hell is this? So, it is very geeky. It is very geeky. And I'm sure, you know, this is certain, I guess you would call maybe a genetic profile that probably a lot of these people fit. You know, that isn't much different maybe than geeks today.
Yeah, I certainly agree. And there's a thought I had. It was Elaine Pagels who said, if you, orthodoxy is like grade school, Gnosticism is like grad school when it came to philosophical inquiry and all that. But to me, it was orthodoxy was like sword and sorcery. It was out in the desert with miracles and this and that. When I read Gnosticism, I found science fiction versus sword and sorcery, because the Gnostics would just take you to parallel worlds and gigantic alien monsters that you had to confront. It was like what Eric Davis said in Nomad Codes, that Gnostic texts crackle with a sci-fi sensibility. Would you agree with this, Chris?
Oh, absolutely. But let's not forget, like, some of the saints' stories either. I mean, look at the story of Saint Anthony. I mean, come on.
They're out there.
You know, I mean, I was just reading the story of St. Anthony, and it's like, who took this seriously? I mean, the story of St. George, a lot of these stories are just bizarre. And even the ones that aren't just flat out bizarre are just really kind of hard to swallow. So I think even in that way, there isn't that much of a difference between, you know, Gnosticism and Orthodoxy in that sense. But, you know, within there, I think maybe Pagels does have a point that within Gnosticism that you do have this kind of geeky, off the wall craziness, but you also have this very dry, Platonic, speculative, philosophic, these treatises that are very, very hard to plow through. You know, I personally, I find some of that stuff really hard to get through. You know, some of the stuff, but it's interesting because you know, you'd read stories that you would have Orthodox priests who, you know, on one hand would be preaching an Orthodox gospel to their flocks during the day, and then reading some of these Gnostic speculative treatises at night. I mean, according to some scholars.
Now, Chris, I'd like to ask you about another topic, which you write in The Secret Sun, which is basically always a warning against the alternative heterodox movements that you never know where they come from or when they lose their luster. I mean, you were talking about John Lennon, and it reminds me of a quote. He said, "Join a movement and then jump out before they go stale." And one of these movements is the New Atheist Movement, and you've written a lot about these guys. And yeah, the sigh, I felt there was going to be a sigh somewhere. What's the deal with the New Atheist Movement?
Well, the New Atheist Movement had always been bubbling under the surface. It really popped up in 2004 when people like Sam Harris and Richard Dawkins and Christopher Hitchens all sort of wrote books all at the same time, which, you know, you've always got to wonder when there's that kind of coordination, it's never accidental. But it really caught fire during the 2012 election. Oh boy, what a coincidence. There was a pharmaceutical heir who was funding all this, and also a billionaire hedge fund type. You know, a lot of this really grows out of PsyCop in the 70s. PsyCop's a really interesting group because at the same time, the fundamentalist movement was really rampaging across the country, taking over local governments, taking over local school boards, really posing an imminent, clear and present danger to the Constitution of the United States. PsyCop was worried about crystal gazers and homeopathy and things like that. They were worried about the New Age movement, which was probably less than 100,000 people in the entire United States at the time. This is what they were worried about. What a surprise. Look at the membership of PsyCop. Almost the entire movement were people who drew government salaries. Oh, jeez. Oh, my goodness. People working for state universities, people working for state laboratories and things like that. And what do? They go out and hire a bunch of magicians, people who are experts in deceiving people to train them in how to draw up ways to misdirect people and things like that. You can find all this stuff online. I really don't like to go into this stuff. It's really depressing and disgusting. You can find a lot of this stuff online.
And on the other hand, Chris, what is going on with the New Age movement? Another thing you've written plenty about, most recently in your post, "Everything Old is New Age Again." What is going on with the New Age movement? What should we worry about them? I think you mentioned once it's centralized, then we should start worrying.
Yeah. Well, it almost feels like the seeds are being sown because all of a sudden the New Age movement is everywhere. There was a recent poll taken that New Agers who are referred to in polls as spiritual but not religious now comprise 7% of the American population. And if you look in any major large-sized town or city, I mean, you'll see this. Yoga is more mainstream than NASCAR now. You'll see health food stores, Trader Joe's, Whole Food. You know, you see these stores everywhere. I mean, I remember health food stores used to be little holes in walls. You know, you have the mindfulness and lucid dreaming movements. I mean, these, you'll read about these in mainstream news outlets all the time now. You're hearing more and more about psychedelic research in the mainstream media. You know, not a week goes by when you're not hearing a major story about this. Every decent-sized city, you're going to see Reiki therapists, astrologers, nutritionists, feng shui advisors, self-improvement counselors, positive thinking counselors. Stuff is everywhere. You know, what is it all leading to? I don't know. One of the things I wrote about when I wrote about the Secret Star Trek series is that the Rockefellers, you know, basically built a New Age empire in California with the Institute of Noetic Sciences and the California Institute of Integral Studies and a number of other institutions, the Zen Center, things like that, Esalen. They had a lot of money in Esalen. There really is a network of major New Age institutions now that have a lot of money behind them. You know, people like Al Gore are involved in this. A lot of people, Gene Houston, Deepak Chopra, you know, major celebrities are involved in this. Edgar Mitchell, the astronaut. So I don't know exactly what is going on yet, but all I know is that right now there is a lot of money being put into this movement. Where it's all leading, I can't tell you yet, but it does seem like groundwork is being laid. Because I'll tell you, you know, I remember, you know, the whole harmonic convergence in 1987. You know, I remember when this just burst into the media, you know, and then you had Oprah. Oprah was putting forth a lot of people like Eckhart Tolle and Deepak Chopra, a lot of these people, The Secret. You know, these things sort of come and go, but the movement remains the same. Where it's going, I can't tell you, but there is an infrastructure in place, ready.
Yeah, more than ready.
It's ready. You know, it's ready for when something does happen. Where exactly it's going, I can't tell you, but it's going somewhere. 7% of the American population, that's not an insignificant number.
No, not at all.
Yeah, you know? I mean, that's probably around 24 million people. And you're talking, of those 24 million people, you're talking middle class, upper income. Those are people who any movement would want, you know? I mean, you can see this for yourself. You know, go into any of these stores. Look at who's buying this stuff. I mean, have you ever been to into a Whole Foods store? I mean, that stuff is not cheap.
No, that's for the elite.
You know, I mean, all these therapies and stuff, none of that stuff is cheap. An hour with a Reiki therapist is going to cost you upwards of like $150, you know?
Yeah, it's pretty serious. It's definitely got its capitalistic wheels on. And on the, you're a very private person, Chris, but one thing you are open about, both in your blog and also on social media, is presenting your dreams. Why do you do that? Seems to tie in with your visions as a kid. It comes out.
I try not to do too much. I got to tell you, there's really not too many things more boring than making people listen to your dreams.
Yeah? I had a strange dream. Well, when are you going to have a normal one, man?
Yeah. What I'll usually do is talk about it when it, you know, syncs up maybe to a news story or something significant. you know, or maybe something that somebody else was talking about. You know, it's usually only when there's a reason for it, you know? I'll never just sort of pop in and go, hey, listen to my dreams, kids, you know? And then this happened. And then this happened. No, wait, don't go. Then this happened.
Yeah, I've been there before. What advice would you have for people on the social media and on the internet? I know you recently were writing about how the internet is killing everything. Parody, everything is being killed by the internet. But we go there still.
Yeah, I'll tell you, the internet is really becoming the Borg song. And any Star Trek fans will know exactly what I'm talking about. I think a lot of problems that are going on right now are due to passivity. You know what I'm saying? Due to the fact that people are letting things happen. And maybe what needs to be the next phase is that people need to be a little more proactive, need to be a little more proactive about organizing, need to be a little more proactive about getting their act together and getting together with other people, need to be more proactive about seeking out information rather than just letting the media backwash just drip over their head, you know? I think that that's really, you know, sort of the next phase. I mean, the internet's been around. I mean, I've been on the internet since like the early 90s. I remember when I was first on the internet. I mean, it was like a drug. I mean, it was just like, oh my God. I was just so excited. And this is just like, we're talking like 2400 BPS, you know, AOL, charge by the minute. I mean, just ridiculous charges, you know. But I just couldn't get enough, man. I was just like, oh, my God, give me more. And it was all just like ASCII floating by. I don't know, man. I miss those days like crazy. It was just so exciting. It's nothing like that now. And you know, the amount of information and the access and ease, it's like the Model T and like an F-111, you know, not even comparable. But I don't know. It's so hard. I mean, people have their lives to live. You know, they've got to struggle with just getting through the day. I totally understand that. But, you know, at the same time, I mean, you know, this is, you were put here for a reason. You're in your situation for a reason. You know, you have your life to live, and you have, you know, certain responsibility to fulfill. You know, I really truly believe that. You know, I mean, you're here at this time for a reason. I don't believe that's an accident. I am like more than ever. The more I see of naturalism and materialism, and the more I see the results of it, the more I see the disastrous consequences of that kind of thinking and how it, where it leads to people, you know, just the crushing despair, you know, the aggression, negativity, and existential malaise that so many people are feeling right now because they've swallowed this poison pill. And the more I want to resist that, you know, it's hard. You know, he's definitely swimming against a very strong current. But you are not alone. You know, there are forces greater than yourself, for sure. And there are ways you can learn to tap into those forces. I believe that more than I ever have. I know that. I don't even believe that anymore. You know, I know that. I'm convinced of it. How exactly I will use that is an open question, but you know, I am more of a Gnostic now as a knower than I ever was before. But I also have more of a knowledge of this prison that we are all trapped in than ever before. But, you know, we haven't, you know, greater minds than any of us have walked this path before us and have left journals for us to read, you know?
Yeah.
I mean, you know, these people left records for a reason. You know, it's like somebody was trapped on a desert island. They left a message in a bottle for us. I can't think of a better metaphor than that.
Like the old police song.
Yeah, I think people need to just stop being so passive and waiting, you know, for the answer to come to them. I think, you know, we've all grown up in an environment that is based in a culture that is waiting for revelation, is waiting for the skies to open and the answer to be handed down, you know? And, you know, I don't believe in revelation. I believe in an evolution. I believe in a discovery, you know, that you need to discover. You need to go out and discover. You know, you're not passive. You're not a passive actor. You're an active actor. You know, you have a certain responsibility. What's that line from Tom Hanks line? If it was easy, everyone would do it. You know,
right.
And I feel that that's, you know, maybe in an existential sense that's the same conundrum we're all faced with. You know, if it was easy, everyone would do it, then what would be the point, you know? But I am more convinced than ever. But at the same time, I see that the things have gotten worse than they've ever been before, you know, at least in my lifetime. You know, I'm sure that things were much worse than they are now during the Black
Panther. yeah, a perspective.
Much worse in other times in history, believe me. I mean, you know, this is paradise compared to Genghis Khan, who is reducing cities to ashes.
Yeah, mowing down nations.
But at the same time, I mean, we live in a world that's being deprived of meaning, that's being deprived of. People just don't feel any reason to get out of bed in the morning. They don't feel any connection. They don't feel like they belong. They feel alienated. That's when you ask me why I feel that these are Gnostic times, and I feel the best answer to that, the simplest answer to that, is that people feel profoundly alienated. And I don't think that's an accident. I think that people are being alienated. You know, and it's everyone. No one is immune from it.
I certainly agree with you, and I think those are wise words. And to end, Chris, what are you working on next? Are you still sticking to the Secret Sun, or what's going on?
You know, I've been busy with my day job for so long, and I've had so many projects that I've started and had to stop. You know, it's been terrible. I've had so many projects. I have, in various stages of, various stages of completion or production, a number of different book projects that I, at one point in time, I was very excited about and had to stop working on them, you know, because of my responsibilities. And my responsibilities always have to come first. I mean, it's just, you know, the reality of life. I definitely want to relaunch my podcast, but I will only do so if I can find, you know, really interesting people that I want to talk to. I definitely want to write another book. I've been doing research for it. What I will probably do is take all the other book projects that I've had in various stages of production and fold them into this other project. I think that will probably be the best thing to do, most satisfying thing to do. I'm going to continue to blog, probably do shorter pieces, more iPhone-friendly pieces, less lots of these book-length kind of series that I think are just too much to ask people to read. Particularly since most of the people I know now experience the internet on their phones. So I will definitely keep pieces shorter and easier to read. And keep the longer, more involved work for book projects.
Well, we certainly look forward to whatever you put out next. I think that's all the time we have today, Chris. I'd like to thank you very much for coming on again on Aeon Byte and giving us the skinny on Gnosticism and our wonderful times.
Thank you very much. I appreciate it.